Check out Boston George, famous without the fortune, now streaming on Fandor.com. Get the real story of the events that inspired the hit film Blow.
Hey, welcome back to the Fandor Video Podcast. Welcome, Chris Kelly.
Hey, you.
How are you?
All right, doing great.
And our amazing producer.
Excellent conversation.
Oh, yeah, you're right about that. And our amazing producer, Bryn. Hello, Bryn.
Oh, thank y'all. Gave myself air horns there.
Here we are with part two of our interview with the great Bill Lustig. The first part of the interview, we talked about grindhouse theaters, Maniac, shooting with live ammo. Bill, I want to begin by talking about filmmaking today. Do you find yourself mentoring filmmakers? Do you make yourself available if people need advice and help?
You know, I sometimes do, but, you know, everybody is, how can I put it? There isn't the community there once was. You know, like I'll give you an example of a guy I mentored back when was Sam Raimi.
Mm-hmm.
And Bruce and Rob Tavern. You know, they had made Evil Dead after I had made Maniac and Vigilante, and they were asking advice, and I was very forthcoming. I was totally honest with them and, you know, and gave them advice back then. But I feel as though that the filmmakers today, it's funny. There's not a community of filmmakers. I mean, yeah. The only person who I guess, I can't say I mentor, but somebody who I he's asked me for advice. We're friends, Nick Winding Refn.
Hmm.
We've been friends for 20 plus years.
Yeah.
This is one of the things that I think that what Fandor is trying to create more community in the online space and trying to promote the idea that it is supposed to be a community endeavor. That's one of the things that from the beginning at Fandor we wanted to touch on, and it's great to be able to do some of that through the podcast.
Well, you know what's strange is I don't run into many active young filmmakers. I'll give you an example. For many years, I would do a talk to the School of Visual Arts when I lived in New York. The School of Visual Arts, the graduating class, I would do a class basically on, you know, what the real world is like. And now this is School of Visual Arts. These people are in the film program, they're in the graduating class. And I found myself knowing more about the new films that were playing in theaters than these people. I don't know how to explain it, but I don't see that passion.
Yeah.
You know, that they that they have for movies. They seem to be oblivious to it.
Yeah. I've done my fair share of talks at schools as well, and you're right, that is a big problem. The passion, the want to be in the theater constantly, watching scenes over and over again, in memorizing moments of films. I mean, as I was doing research on you, I read that you saw the movie Deliverance 70 times. Is that true?
Well, actually, that's because I was an usher.
Okay.
Great. Well, what a way to kind of serve your film addiction.
Well, I had to close the theater.
Uh-huh.
So I should probably say I saw the last half of Deliverance
70 times.
Oh, hilarious. Outside of filmmaking, what do you enjoy? Are you into sports? Are you into fine dining, travel? Like, what do you like outside of films?
Fine dining. I don't know. I'm not really a fine diner.
Okay.
We got my, I got my, my handful of restaurants I go to in LA, but the same in New York. I'm not an explorer. And
What about sports? You like sports?
Not really. I sometimes watch hockey.
Uh-huh. Okay.
That's hockey is about
what
it.
About travel? What about travel? You like travel?
I love traveling. I used to travel once a month on average. I mean, I just did over the summer. I was in Slovenia. Okay. I was in New York last month. But this month, my Northern California trip got canceled. I'm usually a week or two on average a month I travel.
I've heard you. Oh, go ahead.
No, it's okay.
I've heard you say that there's some projects that interest you that might get you back in the director's chair. Can you tell us what these projects are?
Oh, God, I'd rather not because...
Come on!
Come on! I got a script here that I really like. And I don't want to... No, I can't... Because first, you wouldn't even know what it is. There's some things I thought about.
Let me ask you this. This script in front of you, is it a horror movie? Is it a thriller? Is it a romantic comedy?
Probably it's more of... It's a horror... a horror detective movie.
Okay.
Yeah. One of my favorites is Angel Heart. I love Angel Heart. You guys.
And in this script that's on your desk, that is this detective horror movie, in your mind, have you already cast the lead actor?
I keep changing that.
Well, tell us like one or two of the people that you were thinking.
Well, recently, I really would like to work with Simon Rex. I thought he was great in Red Rocket. He's someone I like. Did you see West Side Story?
Yes.
Haven't seen it yet.
Actor who played Bernardo in it, I thought he was terrific.
Okay.
And I think he'd make a terrific leading man. I'm always interested in somebody who is unconventional.
Mm-hmm. Oh, are there two or three people who stand out to you in your career who you would consider to be the most important in terms of what they did for you, in terms of killing themselves to help you be successful?
Well, I have to say Pete Savage.
Who's Pete Savage?
Peter Savage. You can look up his IMDb. He made a lot of independent films. He then went into the adult business. He made a couple of adult movies that I worked on. But he was my film school in the sense that working on his movies, I learned all the technical aspects of filmmaking. He was tremendous. Another person would be Phil D'Antoni. Phil D'Antoni was the producer of Bullet, The French Connection, and The Seven Ups. And Phil D'Antoni and Kenny Unt, who was his production manager, opened a lot of doors for me. When I went to do my first adult film, again, I was 21 years old, and I didn't have credit, I didn't have any credentials, nothing. And these guys got the labs to work with me, got the equipment house to work with me, so I owe a lot to them because they opened doors for me. And I would say the other person would be Joe Spinell, because first I met a lot of people through Joe, and more importantly, I learned about movie making and acting from Joe. And when we did Maniac, it was a tremendous learning experience for me, and I just. I learned a lot from Joe. I learned a lot from him. He was great. He was crazy, but he was great. And another person who was a dear friend who died a couple of years ago was Bob Forster. I mean, yeah. He and I, we would have breakfast once a week. When I was in, when I'd be in LA, we'd have breakfast once a week, and I miss him dearly. And he was somebody who I, who I used to spend time with.
We have a special guest, and this is the kid who prepped me for the interview with you, Bill. I don't think you're going to have a bigger fan on this planet.
His name is... who signed the Rocky poster behind you? Is that Stallone?
No, it was, it's a stupid story. Kelly Clarkson signed it. Do you know who that is? The singer?
Yes. Yeah. Why would she, was she in Rocky?
No, when we have our lunch or our dinner, I'll tell you the Kelly.
Okay. Tell me the story.
All right. Anyway, we have a special guest. His name is Jake. Can we bring Jake on?
Yep.
Uh-huh. Hi, everyone. How's it going?
Hey, Jake. Welcome to the show. Jake is one of our colleagues at Fandor. And Jake, we're going to let Jake ask you one question. He's always, he's been dying to know. So go ahead, Jake. It's all you.
Okay. So from a friend of mine, I heard that you have a pretty interesting story involving Sonny Landham when you were working at the
CIA. Oh, my God. Sonny. No, I'm going to say it the way he would say it. Sonny. Sonny.
Okay.
No, Bill. Sonny Landham. Yeah.
So tell us who Sonny Landham is real quick, because none of us know who he is.
Sonny Landham, you would know from the movie 48 Hours. He was the Indian who was partnered with James Remar.
Okay.
And, you know, he was the big guy. The big guy with the crazy smile. He was also in Predator, the first Predator movie. But Sonny had an adult past. And he went by the name Sonny Landham. He never went by any other name. And I was working on an adult film called Sylvia. And Sonny Landham was in the movie. But what had happened is the girl who played the lead, who to this day I cannot understand, this girl was so unappealing. There was just nothing about this girl who I found at all attractive whatsoever. And Sonny was her babysitter. We brought him on because she fell in love with Sonny, big guy. He couldn't stand her, but we were paying him to stay with her and to make sure she shows up. You know, he was also in the movie. And towards the end of the shoot, I was left to do some scenes to, I guess you call it direct, but they really, it was just people walking down the street, second unit type stuff. And whatever it was, this girl who I couldn't stand, maybe she knew I couldn't stand her. I must have said something to her that I can't remember. We were in the kitchen and I was leaving the kitchen and she came after me with a knife and she was going to stab me in the back. And Sonny grabbed her and hit her and her wig went flying and he saved me. I mean, I was at least going to get badly cut from this lunatic. And that was my Sonny. There was also another Sonny story. Sonny, when he'd get a load on, watch out. He was a wild man. And we were staying at this motel in Long Island and shooting this movie. And I had hooked up with this girl who I met at a diner that we were going to for dinner. And so one night I said, guys, I'm not hungry. I'm not going to go to the diner. I was meeting the girl at my room at the motel. And of course, Sonny figured this out. And what happened is he breaks the door down on the adjoining room, picks me up out of bed. Now, I was lighter than I am today, but I still wasn't like 110 pounds or anything. And he picks me up out of bed and carries me naked with just a sheet on me outside. The whole crew was waiting.
Oh, wow.
That's incredible.
I'm in Sonny's arms. He was funny. There was this steakhouse on the corner in New York. And when we'd go there to eat, I'll never forget, he would say to the waitress, but please cook my steak till it screams.
Nice.
Yeah, it was just matter of fact. You know, cook it till it screams.
Nice.
Jake, Thank you for coming on, Jake.
Great question, Jake. Thank you.
Great question, bro.
Thank you. Thank you, Bill, for doing this, by the way.
Yeah, it's great. I mean, Sonny Landham, I think, passed away, didn't he?
Yeah, he passed away 2 years
ago. Yeah, that's what I heard. He was a nice guy. I liked him.
Let's end the interview with this. You're a busy guy. You're well accomplished. Bill, what do you do to reset? What do you do to recharge?
What do I do to recharge? Let's see. I like working out. I just worked out. I have a trainer that comes 3 days a week, and I just worked out this morning. I like doing that. Let's see. You know, I'm thinking, because like COVID has just changed my whole life. It really has. I mean, you know, there's so much that I want to do, and you just, you know, I would go to the movies. I love going to the theater, you know, to see movies like a couple of times a week. And I just don't, you know, I do it occasionally. I go mostly to the DGA to see movies, but you know, it's just a weird time.
Yeah. No, it definitely has been.
Oh my God. We used to have these great dinners over at Genghis Cohen, this Chinese restaurant here.
I know Genghis Cohen. That's a great restaurant.
Yeah, we would go there on Sundays. It was, and all the people that, you know, they're dying. Bob died. My friend Frank Pesh, who, you know, you might know him. Did you see Beverly Hills Cop? He was the guy at the beginning selling cigarettes. He's been in all my movies. Jake, you probably know. I always give him a cameo. And, he's right now in the hospital with, with dementia.
Wow.
It's terrible. Yeah. You know, the older you get, these people fade away. So hopefully if you guys come down, we'll go to Genghis and we'll have a bang up dinner.
Let's do it. Let's do it.
His name is Bill Lustig. Bill, on behalf of me and Bryn and Jake, we really hope you sit back in that director's chair. We really, really hope that you do that detective horror movie.
Well, great. I look forward. And fellas, I can't wait to see you guys.
All right.
Thanks so much, Bill.
All right, Bill. Thanks so much.
All right. Thanks so much. Take care.
All right. Bye.